Hello everyone, and thanks for attending this talk. I'm sure last few days have been very enriching experience for all of us, and I'm sure today is even going to be better. I'm not sure about you, but at least for me, because my evening flight is already cancelled. So with that, let's start. Today I'm going to talk about a scheduling simulator for capacity estimation of Kubernetes cluster. Although it says simulator, but it's a real utility that you can run against your cluster. Simulator and simulation is just part of the design. Just a little bit about myself. I work at Red Hat. I've been a core contributor to Kubernetes and OpenShift for several years. And for the last several months, I've been working on these two new tools, descheduler and cluster capacity. Cluster capacity is the one I'm going to talk about today. And this cluster capacity effort is completely community effort. There have been several people involved in its design and its development, so I'm not the only one. Here's the agenda of my talk. I'll first talk about like why we really wanted to build this tool. Then I'll talk about like why we have designed the way we have designed. And then I'll talk about some of its feature, and then how we can use basically some of the best practices we have learned by running on some real clusters. And in the end, I'll give a demo, I think the most important part of this talk. So a bit of history. Before OpenShift v3, that is based on Kubernetes, we have entirely different implementation of OpenShift in version v2 and version v1. And our OpenShift ops team had a tool where they could input something called gears. You might think them as similar to pods, but I mean they are not really similar to pods. And then that utility and tool used to give some sort of like output a number of instances. And based on that, our ops team used to decide or used to take some actions, like whether we want to add more nodes or more capacity or not. So that's how it started. Because when we moved to OpenShift v3, that is entirely based on Kubernetes, that tool was no longer useful, and we wanted to build something similar for OpenShift v3. So with this tool, basically we wanted to answer two very simple questions. How much capacity is left in a cluster, and when to add more capacity to a cluster. If you have been running some kube cluster, and you have been doing capacity planning, you might be wondering about even so many other questions. But we just started with these two questions. Another thing we considered workload type. Like we wanted to have tool that could process like uniform workload and variable workloads. Uniform means your applications have same requirements, and variable means your applications have different requirements. Another thing we had in our mind when we were designing and we were working on this tool, we wanted to start with very simple utility, very lightweight. We didn't start this tool with very ambitious goal, like we want to have all the features related to capacity planning in this world. We just wanted a very simple tool that can do its job and what kind of questions or answers. Answers we are looking for, it can answer those questions. So now, because we have been talking about capacity, what does it mean in the context of Kubernetes? When you have application you want to deploy on Kubernetes as a pod, although like you don't directly use pod, you generally use some higher level construct like deployments. So when you think about capacity, the first thing that comes to our mind, resources. What kind of resources are provided in a Kubernetes environment? These resources could be CPU, memory, storage, or some special devices like GPUs. Since we are talking about these resources, another question that came to our mind, like, is it possible when we are thinking about capacity planning, can we just think these resources individually? So basically, like in the context of Kubernetes environment, Can we think capacity in terms of individual resources? Maybe not, and let's see why that is not the case. Because I'm sure most of you are familiar with Kubernetes. Pod is the smallest schedule unit. That means when you specify your application requirement, resource requirement, your pod has all sort of resource requirement. And that means those resource requirements are going to be considered collectively. When the pod is scheduled, you don't consider those resource requirement individually. So that is the main reason we need to have some sort of design where we need to consider all those resources collectively. So as I said, we wanted to have some tool where we can input your pod spec that specifically mimics your application, and we can run that tool against your running Kubernetes cluster, and then it provides number of pods. Because if we know number of pod, like how many number of pod we can schedule for your application, it gives some idea about capacity. And if the number of pods maybe is less than below some number, you may want to add some more nodes, and you can take some access based on that. So this is, I think, why we wanted to have this utility. Let's talk about its design. Initially, we considered two design approaches. Like one is resource-based approach, or you might say resource-centric approach, and another is scheduler-based approach. First, I'll talk about resource-based approach, and then I'll show you what are the disadvantages and why we didn't go with that approach. Although that might seem a little simpler. And why we went with a scheduler-based approach. So just consider, let's say you have your input pod that mimics your application, and you specify some resource requirement, let's say R. And let's say you have your cluster where you have N nodes, and each node is already running some pods. So basically, it shows the remaining capacity on node one. For example, it's very simple to compute. On any node, you can just find what is the total capacity. Then you find how many number of pods are running. Then you just sum for all number of pods, and then you find compute what is the total capacity that is being used, and you just subtract. You get the remaining capacity. And you do that for all the nodes. So that means now you are getting the remaining capacity for that particular resource for your whole cluster. Now it's very simple. You can just divide that your input requirement, and it will give number of instances. But as I said, when we are considering pods in the context of Kubernetes, we need to consider all the resources. That means this process, this computation, now you have to do for all the resources. Once you do that for all the resources, you get the minimum among all the numbers you have got from all the resources. That means that many maximum number of pods can be scheduled. So, if it's we are just considering raw resource-based approach, and we are getting how many number of pods can be scheduled. But let's see what are the disadvantages. And maybe to put it in other words, is it enough to just consider resource only in the context of Kubernetes? Let's talk about that. What are the other factors in a Kubernetes cluster that impact scheduling? For example, let's talk about fragmentation. We might take an example of CPU. Let's say your input pod request is it's asking for 500 millicore. And let's say you have several nodes and it shows remaining CPU capacity on each node. If you sum them, it might seem several pods of that request can be scheduled. But you know the way scheduling works, because no individual node can satisfy that requirement, we cannot schedule that node. So this is one disadvantage of that approach. Then, if you are aware how actual scheduling works in Kubernetes, when you using kubectl, you create your pod, it goes through several stages. one of the stages admission plugins. The way you have configured your cluster, the way you have set up your admission plugin policies, what you input and what is the output. The output port might be different because there are two kinds of admission plugins. One kind of admission plugins is that modify your input port based on the way you have configured your cluster. And then you have another set of admission plugins that might do something else, maybe, but not, but don't modify your input pod. So if you just consider your input pod without getting through them all the admission plugins, the way your cluster is doing, you might not get the actual or maybe more accurate answer. It might be in fact wrong. So that is another reason. What are the other reasons? What are the other factors that impact scheduling? So if you are aware of several features we have in Kubernetes, the way like we have multi-tenancy, the way we have so many, like you have segmentation in your cluster. So I'm sure like you must have heard about node selectors and node affinities. Because when you have node selectors, that means you have sort of segmented your cluster in several parts. And let's say if you have your application, you are specifying some node selector, that means you cannot consider the whole cluster. You just need to consider only those nodes with that node selector. That is one thing. Then we have node tents and pod tolerances. Tents are also like you are segmenting your cluster because only the pods, those are tolerating those tents, can be scheduled. And if your application has that specific requirement for those nodes that are tented, that means you only need to consider those nodes. You cannot consider the whole all the nodes in your cluster. Something that we were doing with resource-based approach, because we just had the idea or view of resources, we did not have the view of all the other factors that are impacting scheduling. Another thing I want to mention, like although it might seem in your cluster all the nodes are homogeneous, but I think they are not. Even though you might have similar resources on each resources on each nodes, but still like they're like you might have different node selectors, tents and other things that makes your nodes like heterogeneous. And then you have like pod affinities or anti affinities, like depending upon your applications, your application might have affinity to some other application, and that way it also impacts scheduling. And again, like you just cannot consider a raw resource based approach. And another, it's a very simple thing, like max number of pods on a node. I'm sure you must have seen how many max number of pods you can schedule on a node. You might have all the resources available on your resource, but if you have exceeded this this limitation, then you cannot schedule more nodes. Then definitely like pods storage requirement, the way you have configured your clusters and the applications you are running, maybe all nodes cannot satisfy that your application storage requirements. So for that particular application, again, you cannot consider all the nodes. You only need to consider those nodes that are satisfying its storage requirements. So all these things impact scheduling. And when you are doing sort of like capacity planning for your application, you really need to consider all these factors. I think another question that might come to our mind, maybe is it possible, like all these factors we are considering, we might just implement as part of resource-based approach? Yeah, that's possible. But if we had done that, what we would have got? The default scheduler, the native scheduler we already have in Kubernetes. So why to reinvent the wheel when we already have that? So that's the main idea, like why we wanted to go with the scheduler-based approach. And now I'll talk about like how exactly it works, and what's its architecture. First, it creates an instance of the default scheduler. Basically, it uses the same code, so it's like you are creating the same scheduler. But how it is it different from the default scheduler that we have in Kubernetes? It maintains its local resource store. Why it does that? So that it does not impact the actual cluster. When it runs its analysis, it only runs it in its local resource store. initially it fetches the cluster state from your running cluster, and as I said, it runs its analysis based on that. Again, it does not, after that, it does not impact your real cluster. Then what it does, whatever input pod you have provided, it schedules them one by one, the way default scheduler does. And it keeps doing that until it gets some error that more pods cannot be scheduled. Another thing what it does, like it does not bind those pods to nodes, because what it's doing analysis to get the number, the maximum number of pods that can be scheduled. So it does not bind pods to nodes. Because if you bind pods to node, that means you are really impacting your cluster, so it does not do that. And as I said, like it stops when no more pods can be scheduled. So I mean, this is the main like core of this cluster capture tool. As I said, like we really wanted to have a very simple tool that can answer like what questions we wanted to answer. So what are the features we have? I would say it's kind of like proactive approach, where like you have your cluster and you have this utility and you run against that. I mean, it's not like you have to run this utility manually. I'll show you like how you can automate that. Either you can have like traditional scripting or anything. But it's a kind of proactive approach where that you are regularly running this utility against your cluster, and for your application, it's showing how much capacity is left. And then based on that, you can take some actions. And it can be run via command line or as a pod. I'll show you like what are the advantages if you run that as a pod. And if you have been running Kubernetes cluster, sometimes you might modify your default scheduler policy. Maybe you want to do something more customization of your default scheduler. Because as I said, it is also an instance of default scheduler. So you can also modify or provide your custom scheduler policy that you are using in your actual cluster, so that it can exactly mimic the actual cluster, your actual cluster. And as I said, like by default, it outputs how many maximum number of pods can be scheduled. But if you are not interested in that, maybe you just want to know, is it possible to schedule like just 100 pods of my application, or maybe 500 pods of my application? You can specify that max limit, then it will stop as soon as it sees that it finds that that many number of pods can be scheduled. It says yeah, it outputs that number, and if it's not possible, then it will output some smaller number. And pods resource requirement from limitance, that means like by default you must specify some sort of resource requirement. Like let's say like either CPU or memory, because if you don't specify that and like you are just trying to find number of pods for best effort pods, it's not possible to do any analysis, because if you don't have any like raw resource requirements, I mean there is no way you can run any analysis. So basically you must specify that. But if you don't specify that, another thing what you can do, in your cluster, you can create another namespace and then you can specify default limit ranges. If you are familiar with that, that's one way of like defining default resource requirements. And then it will fetch it from there. If that application is also going to run the same namespace or project. And another good thing what it does, it shows not only the total number of nodes, it also shows like how many pods on each node can be distributed. Let's say like it shows like 100 pods can be scheduled, but it also shows maybe 10 can be scheduled on this node, 5 can be scheduled on this node. So it also provides the distribution. So you might see like what are the nodes like where we are able to schedule more pods, and what are those nodes where we are scheduling less number of pods. So it might give also more idea about your cluster. Also currently it only considers uniform workloads. Basically when I say like uniform workload, that means at one time you can only specify one pod, one input pod. Also like if you have like multiple applications, definitely you can run that multiple times. And I'll show you like what is the like what complexity is associated like if we consider variable workloads. But definitely it's not like that cannot be solved, but I'll discuss about that soon. So let's talk about like how we can really use this tool. So it can be, as I said, it can be run as a command line tool. And you just have to provide two parameters, kubeconfig to authenticate with your cluster and input pod spec. So I think, as I said, the one of the goals we had in the beginning, we wanted to have very simple utility. And I think if you just, if you can run your utility by just providing these two parameters, I mean, at least I think this is simple enough. And as I said, like output is the number of pod that can be scheduled. And again, the same thing, like resource request must be specified either in your pod spec or as part of limit ranges in your namespace. And it has that verbose flag. Without verbose flag, it just outputs the number. And the reason why we did that, because so that you might have some automated scripting or some tooling so that you can just see the number and then you can, your scripting can take some actions. But you really wanted to, if you really want to see some more, like how on each node, how many pods can be scheduled, you can use this verbose flag. So what are the best practices? If yesterday, if you might have, maybe you saw a keynote by Clayton Coleman, and I think he was talking about like OpenShift online clusters, and we have been deploying these tools on OpenShift, our online cluster, to get more experience. And based on that, like we have found like how, what are the best practices we can have to run these kinds of tools. So first of all, you can. It would be better if you run this tool as a pod, either as a kube job or cron job, because then you get all the advantages you get by running a job or cron job. But for that, if you really want to do, you need to set up this environment variable cc underscore in cluster to be true, so that the code knows that it's going to run inside a pod. It's called something called like in cluster config in kube. Although like we might have some other way of also doing that, but I think this was I think easiest way to achieve that. And then when you are running, I mean, I think it's true for any application or anything that you are running in a pod, you don't want to give all the permissions in your clusters, right? You always minimize the permissions that are required for your application, and that is true for cluster capacity tool also. So basically, the better thing would be you just create another service account for that, so that you can limit permissions for that service account, so that it, if somehow or for whatever way it gets hacked, it does not, it's the harm is limited. So what are those minimum required RBAC permissions? So these are the minimum required RBAC permissions you just need to run this tool. I mean, it's very similar to what default scheduler needs. The only thing it does not need like bind permission, because as I said, it does not bind pods to node. So this is the only like minimum permissions you need to run this tool. And then for easier usability, it's better like if you input your pod spec as config map, because I think if you have been running clusters and you have been running your applications, config maps are a really easier way to update your configuration. And because config, once you have specified that as config map, you can always mount that as volume inside your cluster capacity pod. So these are like the best practices we have been using to run this tool on our real production clusters. This is the current status. Like we have been testing with kube and OpenShift clusters. It can be run against any kube cluster or any kube certified cluster, because it works with stable kube APIs. Currently it's rebased to kube 1.7, but soon we are planning to rebase to 1.8 and definitely 1.9. And it has been, this tool has been in OpenShift since 3.6 as a tech preview, because we just wanted to have more experience. Although, like I've been talking about OpenShift also, but this is a completely upstream project. It's part of Kubernetes incubator repo. It's completely upstream. Everything is upstream in kube. So let's talk about like what we can do in the future. Like I was talking about admission plugins, but right now we don't have that implemented and integrated in the current code. We definitely want to do that in future versions. Right now, you can only input your pod spec, but when you run your application, definitely you don't run directly as a pod. You always use some higher level construct like replica sets, deployment, jobs, or stateful sets. So definitely we want to have some mechanism where instead of pod, you can also input these things. And again, like as I said, right now we are just considering uniform workload, but we really want to consider variable workloads where like you can input sequence of pods. And as I was talking about, like what is the complexity involved with that? Let's say like you have two applications, and you say, okay, just you input your two applications, and you see you want to know about some more information about capacity. But the problem with that is, when you schedule your like two applications, and you want to know what maximum number of pods we can schedule with those two applications. It is possible, I mean, you can schedule like maybe 10, let's say you can schedule 30 pods for both applications, but maybe you can schedule 5 pods of first application, 25 of second application, or maybe you can schedule like maybe 20 pods of first application, or 10 pods of second application. So it's like if you just specify your application, it might not give you definitive answer, because there is no definitive answer for that. So better would be if we ask, like, can we schedule like 10, maybe X number of pods of first application or Y number of pods of second applications. But I mean, like what I'm talking about, these are like my understanding. But if you have, definitely like, I would really like to hear like what are your use cases, how we can extend this utility. And if you have some ideas about this existing things we want to do in the future, I would really like to hear. Another thing, like we wanted to consider multiple schedulers, because now Kubernetes support multiple schedulers. Also, like in our scheduling meeting, like we have been discussing whether like how to support these multiple schedulers. So that is another thing like we want to consider. So now time for demo. I'm going to demo it on our production cluster. And this is one of our online clusters, and it has around 150, I think more than 150 nodes. And some of the things I have already done, like for example, I have created service account, I have created cluster, I mean role that I was talking about, and I have also created binding between those two. So those things are already done. Let's see like about config map that we have. So these are the two config maps we have. I think it's visible. Like this is your input pod definition. It's exactly like how you specify your pod spec. So here you have specified request of like 50M CPU and memory of 128, and you have same limits, but it doesn't have to be. The main thing it looks for a request, because the scheduling in Kubernetes clusters works based on request, not based on limits. Now I'm going to create a job. So this is the specification of job I'm going to use. If you see, like this is like this environment variable I'm using, and this cluster config capacity config map that I have created for input pod spec, and it's using its own service account. So what I'll do now, I'll run this job and see. Let's see what happens. Again, it's real products on production cluster I'm running. Might take a few seconds, because there are around 150 nodes. I'm sorry? Around more than 150 nodes. So if you see this number, it says, like we can schedule 3,441 pods of that pod. and it also shows some distribution, like on each node, how many pods can be scheduled. I'm sorry? Oh, okay, okay. So it shows distribution on each node. And if you see the reason, like why it is stopped, after that, like it got insufficient pods or insufficient CPU on some nodes and insufficient memory. Oh, so it seems like right now it has like 136 nodes. I don't know, like 1 week before we have almost more than 180 nodes. Somehow they have been reducing, I don't know why. In fact, I want to show another demo. Right now the input pod spec does not have node selectors. It's considering all the nodes in the cluster. Now I want to show you, if we have node selector as part of your pod input spec, what difference it would make. So let's first delete this. And create another job. I'm going to delete this job. Hopefully it's deleted. Yes. Now let's create another job. Okay, first I'll show you config map for that. So this is the config map. It's exactly similar to the previous one. The only thing it has also a specified node selector, like type equal to compute. Like in our clusters, we have two types of nodes, infra nodes and compute nodes. Infra nodes like where we only run critical system services, and compute node where all the user workloads are running. So I'll show you, like previously in the previous demo, it was considering all infra nodes and compute nodes. But definitely like you don't want to do that, because when you're deploying your application, you are only deploying only this compute nodes. So now let's try that. And let's see what difference it makes. Generally, infra nodes are with more capacity. I just need to make one change to change this to a right config map. And let's create this again. Again, the whole idea behind this to have very simple utility that can do its job. Again. So you see, now we can only schedule 2,247 pods, because now we have restricted number of nodes where like we can schedule our application. And again, it shows the distribution on each node. Like you see, some of the nodes, like you can schedule almost 81, but if you go down on some of the nodes only, you can schedule like 1, 2, or maybe under 10. So yeah, so that's it about my demo. And other thing I wanted to, oops, sorry. Yeah, so these are the resources. As I said, it's a community effort. There have been several people involved in this design and development. And it's a Kube incubator repo. And this project falls under SIG scheduling. You are always welcome to contribute. And if you have more ideas, if you have your use cases, you are always welcome to communicate either via GIT, have contact me directly, or you might attend meetings on SIG scheduling group. You can contact us on Slack channel. And it also have that images where like if you want to test, you can test. So I think that's all I have. Yeah, thank you. So if you have any questions.
Is it respect cluster resources?
Actually, cluster resource quota is part of admission plugins, right? As I said, like we don't consider admission plugins yet. So it might not honor that, but definitely we want to have like consider all the admission plugins.
It's an OpenShift.
Yeah. But I think it's configured as part of admission plugins. If it's working as by default, then like when we are scheduling, because scheduler doesn't consider cluster resource quota, right? It's through admission plugins. But as I said, we are not considering admission plugins yet. Definitely we want to have that. Yeah, hi. No, no, it's not like auto scaling. For that, like we have another project, cluster auto scaler. As I said, like it's more kind of proactive approach. Cluster auto scaler is kind of like reactive approach where like it keeps and when there is problem, then it adds more nodes. But we want to integrate this with cluster auto scaler also. But right now we don't have that. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's a very good question. Like, we don't have that yet, but as I said, like, you're welcome to like join us, contribute. Like, we definitely we work on it. Yeah.
So, we're doing some sort of capacity planning, but we are not using any tools at this point.
I'm sorry, what you are not using?
We are not using any tools.
Okay.
We are doing all the capacity planning manually.
Okay. Yeah, what we can do, we can discuss this offline.
Okay.
I definitely I can talk about that. I think we are running out of time. If you have any questions, like we can discuss offline. Thank you, everyone.